All right. Welcome, everybody, to the 12th semester of the Longhorn Startup Program. Really glad to have you all here. I'm Josh Baer, and I'm the instructor of the course and also an entrepreneur in residence at the Computer Science School here at UT. This course was started in 2011 with Dr. Bob Metcalf, who's here in the audience, and John Butler, and a lot of other people that have contributed along the way. And also want to recognize, I know Bruce Porter's here in the audience somewhere. He's the outgoing head of the Computer Science Department, and this class would not be here at all if it weren't for Bruce. He really reached out to me originally to help start the class, and he's just been our champion throughout the whole time, helping to make it happen. So thank you very much, Bruce. And actually, he probably deserves one more round of applause, because I just want to point out as well, because has it been 8 years that he's been the head of the Computer Science Department? Does anybody know something close like that? I can't see you, Bruce. I don't know if it's out there. But it's been a long time. And is it eight? Yeah. 8 years. And beyond just this class, I think everybody knows Bruce has just been a tireless champion for everything happening here at UT, and especially in the Computer Science Department. And it's come so far in the time that I've been here with him. So let's give him all one more big round of applause for the past 8 years. Thank you, Bruce. Really excited for what we're going to see today. We have a great program ahead. It's going to be about two hours long. And then after this, we have an after party at Spider House, which everybody's welcome to come to. Right now, I want to tell you just a little bit about the program, and then we're going to jump into our first speakers. The program today, we've got a few speakers for about 40 minutes. We'll have about a 10-minute break just to give everybody a chance to chat a little bit more and use the restroom or anything else they might need to, and then we'll go into our 12 pitches. At the end of it all, we're going to award a $5,000 prize, which is another new thing this semester, to one of the startups, and you'll hear a little bit more about that as we go along. We've also got another really exciting announcement at the end of the program for what's going to some exciting changes for the class next semester. One thing I want to leave you with, you heard a little bit of a description of the program in the video. There's two classes, two parts to this program. In the fall, we teach the seminar. It's open to any student in the university, and typically we have about 200 students register. The idea is to inspire students about entrepreneurship, expose them to great entrepreneurs and speakers, and get them thinking about lots of different things. It's a way for us to meet them, to bring them all together so they meet each other. We kick off each class of that semester with an open pitch pizza night where there's free pizza and anybody can come and pitch their startup idea to me and whoever the guest speakers might be. And then we have some incredible guest speaker every week come in and talk to the students about their story of starting their company. Then in the spring, what we're going to see today is we have the lab. And the lab is a much more exclusive version of the class. It's only for teams of students. They apply as a team, and they have to actually have a startup that they're already working on. They don't just apply with an idea. It's got to be something that they've already started to move the needle on. And we've got 12 of those student teams here this semester. And I think you're going to be really blown away when you see what they've accomplished and see how well they present what they're working on. So, also want to make sure that you help us get the word out for other great students that should be part of this class. And what you can register for right now is the seminar, which will be next fall. And the way you learn about anything about our program is just to go to our website. It's longhornstartup.com. There's a lot of information up there, but in particular, that first tab that says register has a link to both the syllabus for the seminar and the lab, as well as how you can apply to be part of it. And so I would really encourage you all to both check that out and spread the word to anyone else you know that's a student entrepreneur here at campus that should be part of it. These are the different course numbers. We have actually 9 course numbers across 6 different schools for all the different programs that we run. But these all are the same course, but different ways that you can get credit for it. And these is for the fall class the class coming up this fall, the seminar. If you are in one of these other schools, you can sign up for any of them, but the CS program in particular, in a pretty unusual way in this school, is open to anybody to sign up and take part. So a couple other things. We do have a lot of people to thank for making all this happen, in addition to Bruce Porter, who I already mentioned. We have none of this would be happening today, and we wouldn't be able to be here if it weren't for the support of Walmart. We've had a really... I've seen just over the past 2 years, Walmart really step up their presence here in Austin, at South by Southwest, at Capital Factory, here at UT. This isn't the only thing they're doing here, I think even today at UT. So we really appreciate their support, and I've been really impressed seeing all the innovative things happening with Walmart technology and what they're doing. So because of that, I want to invite Jason Norris out here for a minute just to say a few words and help send our students off with a great start. So here is Jason.
Thank you, Josh. Thanks. So in 2012, I actually made the kind of inexplicable decision to leave Austin and move to Northwest Arkansas to work for Walmart Technology. Last summer, I had the opportunity to come back and kind of serve as Walmart Technology's conduit to the Austin startup ecosystem. They said, hey, you'll get an opportunity to work at this really hip place called the Capital Factory. I looked at some pictures online, and I thought, yeah, that looks awesome. That's like no corporate office I've ever worked in. So little did I know, I would get to get plugged in with Josh Baer and Bob Metcalf, who were pretty much the OGs of the Austin startup scene. And that's been really a lot of fun for us. Everything we do at Walmart really goes to our founder, Sam Walton, right? So entrepreneur who 67 years ago opened a small store in Bentonville, Arkansas, and now our 2.2 million associates serve 270 million customers a week, all because of one man's entrepreneurial spirit. So I had a chance to meet a lot of you tonight. Congratulations. It's really amazing you're able to be full-time students and run startups. I mean, that's an incredible accomplishment. So on behalf of everybody at Walmart Technology, thank you for letting us be a part.
Thank you very much. All right, and a couple other people we need to thank, too. We have, where is the LEA Genesis program delegation? Down here in the front row. It's not just, and it's just us two of you. I know we got a bunch. So we got a bunch of students down here from UTLEA, the Longhorn Entrepreneurship Agency. This was a really much-needed student organization that was created, actually, I think the year after the Longhorn Startup Program started. And really a big part of it is to help support all of the undergrad activities going on here at UT around entrepreneurship. And they help run the Freshman Founders Program, which is another great program, and help to put together the Genesis Investment Program, which is a way where student startups can get investment money to go help their help push their business forward. So like I said, they're sitting down here right in the middle in the second row. And so there's going to be a break in about a half an hour. And when that happens, if you want to learn more about that program, you should come down and talk to them about joining LEA or getting investment money from the Genesis program. All right, so now we're going to jump right into the program, and we've got a great start to kick things off and get us in the right mood. Our first speaker one more thank you how could I forget? We have to thank our mentors. We have so many great mentors that participate in this program, and that's one of the great things that that really, I think, differentiates it and makes it so engaging. When the students come into class each semester, each week, they don't get taught a class. I don't get up and lecture them about different things. They sit and meet one-on-one with different mentors. And these are all the different mentors that came in this semester. On the left-hand side, in bold, you'll see a list of the mentors who are our core mentors that come in every week. And so they make a pretty big time commitment to come in once a week and meet with these teams over the course of the semester to really help push them forward. And one of the cool things about it is most of these mentors are actually founders of companies at Capital Factory. And so as a Not exclusively, but generally, they tend to be a lot closer to the age of the students that are going through the program right now, maybe can relate to them in a different way, and that's been a great, impact over and since we made that addition to the program. And then in addition to that, every week we have guest mentors come in as well, and you can see there's a whole bunch of them, and they're really some of the most successful entrepreneurs here in town, and it's amazing to see them get to interact and work with the students. So if you are a mentor and you're here tonight, please stand up so we can recognize you and give you all a big round of applause, but thank you all so much for helping to make the program happen. All right, and now for our first speaker, and that's going to be Pamela Valdez. And I'm so excited to have Pamela here today. We actually asked her to fly out and be with us. She came out just for this. And I first met Pamela the freshman year of her of school in, I think, 2015. And she had come here from Mexico City as an exchange student and was coming to UT Austin and was so excited about that. And she already had this startup idea that she was working on. And she came down and she was so excited to tell me about this startup. And she tells me all about it. And I ask a bunch of questions. And I find out in the end that her startup is actually a Facebook page. But she did a pretty good job of convincing me that this was a startup. But it was a Facebook page where she had been talking about her startup. And she'd gotten thousands of people to sign up and get engaged about this idea before she ever even really started working on the startup. And then she set to some real determination to turn that idea and that Facebook page into something real. And did it not only so quickly that she could then take part in the lab that spring, but has really taken it really far since. since then. And so Pamela now, just in the 2 years that she's been through that program, she got out of the class. She took a pause from school. She went through the Capital Factory program. She's been nominated. She's been awarded a Peter Thiel Fellowship, which is a really great honor. She got a Y Combinator Fellowship, which is basically a program you go through before going through Y Combinator, and then just completed the most recent class of Y Combinator. And now her startup has much, much more than a Facebook page. It's really doing some amazing things and has attracted significant investment from a lot of really top tier investors, of which I'm really proud to say that I've just followed along, and I've also invested as well. I'm not allowed to invest in any of the startups while they're in the class, but after they leave, it's totally fair game. That's, you know, nothing that I look for more than just really incredible people that I can bet on, and Pamela really stuck out as one of those. So with that, I want to introduce Pamela Valdez and invite her out here to tell you a little bit more about what she's working on. Thanks, Pamela.
I wish that I could fly into the sky so very high, just like a dragon.
Hi, everyone. I'm Pamela. Just like Josh said, I'm Pamela. I'm the CEO and co-founder of Beak. Beak is the biggest book review site in Latin America. We have over 500,000 monthly active users, and we have 10 times more Spanish book reviews than Amazon. Our dream is to actually build the Amazon of Latin America by having the best reviews that help people buy products. So 2 years ago, just like Josh said, I was here on stage. I was in the same spot as this side of the auditorium is. I was on stage pitching Beak just as an idea. Just like Josh said, it wasn't even a startup, it was a Facebook page. So I was on stage pitching my idea, and a lot has happened since then. I basically not only was trying to start my startup, but I was in the worst position to start a startup. I was an exchange student from Mexico, so I had to go back home after the class was over. I didn't know how to code, I didn't have a product, I didn't have a technical co-founder, I didn't have money, I didn't have a team, I didn't have anything. You could basically say I had all the odds against me. And now 2 years have passed, and what's important to mention is I'm still in the same position as most of you are. Doing a startup is still the hardest thing I've ever done. It's not like we have been successful yet. I still work super hard, put up all-nighters, do all these things, trying to make it work. But the important thing is that 2 years have passed, and I'm still trying to figure it out, and I haven't given up. When you don't give up and you keep working hard, good things start to happen. So I'm going to tell you a little bit about my journey since I graduated from Longhorn Startup Lab 2 years ago and what we've accomplished today. So when I started Longhorn Startup Lab, I figured that, Josh and Bob taught me that the most important thing for an early stage startup was getting traction. So getting traction means getting proof that people are interested in your product. In my case, I didn't have a product. So I needed to find another way to test that people were interested in a community for book lovers, which was my initial idea. So what I did was that I created a Facebook page, and I started gathering people to test if they were interested in books in Spanish. So during the class, I grew that Facebook page to over 30,000 people. So by the end of the class, I had 30,000 people, and I would run all my ideas through those people. So I would test my mockups, my prototypes, and that's how I would test if they wanted something related to books in Spanish or not. And this was really helpful. Even though it wasn't a startup or it wasn't a product yet, when I graduated from the class, my biggest challenge was finding a technical co-founder, right? Because you need a developer and someone who can actually build a product. And you guys know how developers are. They're really hard to get in your team. So what I did is that I went to a hackathon in Capital Factory. And when I was at that hackathon, I met my awesome co-founder, Max. And I saw Max and I told him, hey, I've built this Facebook page that has 30,000 people that would use a product related to books. And Max quit his job, joined my team, and we've been together 2 years working on Beak. But the thing that he told me was, I quit my job and joined you because you already had some sort of traction. You already had proof that this was just not a crazy idea. People actually wanted it. So that is the first lesson that I want everyone to remember, which is get traction as soon as possible. Because if you're like me, that you don't know how to code, Or if you are not like me and you're actually a developer, you can spend so much time building the perfect product. And you're all the time tweaking the product and thinking you're gonna make it more beautiful. And that doesn't mean anything. If you don't have traction, the beautiful product doesn't, like, means nothing, basically. So Max and I started working together. I got him on my team. We joined Capital Factory's Accelerator. That was very exciting. And when we were at Capital Factory, we learned so much. We started making progress. We started getting more traction, more users. Now we actually had a product. So now you could actually sign up for Beak. We didn't have an app yet, but we were getting there. And what started happening was that we were growing fast, and I decided I should start raising money. So I dropped out of school and to stay in Austin and try to raise money. And I do that, and I find a small and insignificant surprise, which is, nobody in Austin wants to invest in Beak. And basically, I tried everything. I pitched over 100 investors. I got over 100 no's. Only Josh and Shaquille, who is in this room, invested in me. But other than that, over 100 investors said no to me. I got rejected from tech stars in Austin. One investor even said something like, this is the most stupid idea I've ever heard. And another investor said like, oh, I just can't get excited about books. I got every excuse that someone could ever come up with. And Max and I said like, you know, if they don't get it, it's their problem. We do get it. We do believe we are building something big, and we don't, like, we refuse to give up. So we had heard about this program that Josh mentioned called Y Combinator in Silicon Valley. Y Combinator is the best accelerator in the country because that's where some of the big startups like Airbnb, Dropbox, and Reddit came out of. So after being rejected by 100 investors, we were crazy enough to believe that we could make it into Y Combinator. So we decided to apply, and we found that it was true. It was very, very selective. So we got rejected once, then we got rejected twice, then we got rejected 3 times. But just like I said, when you don't give up and you keep working hard and you keep making progress, good things start to happen. So we applied the 4th time and we actually made it. We got in, and last month we just graduated from Y Combinator's last batch. We thank you. We grew big during Y Combinator. We grew big to over 500,000 monthly active users. And we were able to raise a very nice round of money from some of the top tier venture capital funds in the US. So 2 years ago, when I was sitting in that chair, I never thought this was gonna be possible. I was the exchange student from Mexico and that didn't have a team and only had a Facebook page. So everything is possible, I'm serious. So what I mean is, if you're relentless and resourceful, you can definitely raise money and make it happen. But the most important thing the point that I want to make with this is that raising money is a numbers game. It's super hard, and all of you will face it. All of you will go out and try to raise money for your company, and it's going to be super hard. So even if you get 100 no's from investors in Austin, it doesn't matter, because there are 300,000 angel investors in the US. So if someone in Austin says no, or if 100 people in Austin say no, you still have 300,000 people to go. So it's just a numbers game. The more no's you collect, the closer you are to a yes. You have to think about it that way. That's what I learned when I was starting. if you really keep pushing forward, there's no way you can't raise money. And then once you raise money, because if all of you follow my advice, you will, the most important thing to know is that raising money doesn't mean anything. We just raised money, and that doesn't mean anything. Beak is still just starting. We are still trying to become the Amazon of Latin America. It's not like we are the Amazon of Latin America yet, but we are trying really hard to become that. So once you raise money, you don't have to let it go to your head. You have to be clear that the only thing that is really going to take you to success is having an amazing product with sustained growth. And for that, you need to make something people want. So for 2 years, Max and I have been trying to make something people want. And I want to share with you 4 pieces of advice that we've learned so far. And the first one is, talk to your users. This is so important. You can't make something people want if you don't know what they want. And it sounds so obvious, but a lot of people are just building products for themselves without even knowing if people are needing what they are building. So Max and I would basically go to coffee shops and bookstores in Mexico and spend hours there talking to users and talking to people, figuring out what do they need, how did they find their last book, how could we make it better for them. We got super obsessed about it, and today, with 500,000 users, we still do it. If you go to Beak right now, you'll see a live chat that you can text 24 hours a day, And you'll always get an answer from us because we're always listening to our users and finding out what they need. So talk to users is the most important thing. And then the second one is, okay, so you talk to users and you make something, let's say 20 people want, and that's amazing and they're using it a lot. But now you have to grow from 20 people to 200,000 to 20 million and then 200 million because that's how you actually make something big. So for that, and this is super important and I want everyone to remember this, is that you have to grow the right metric. It's so easy to pick vanity metrics, and I see most of young startup founders make this mistake. I was like, even me when I was starting, which is you start growing vanity metrics. So you start tracking number of signups, number of app downloads, and of course those numbers always go up. You're always gonna have more app downloads as time goes by. But if they download your app, that doesn't mean anything if they're not using it. So what you have to do is pick a metric that actually represents success for your company. In our case, for example, is the number of users that are coming back to Beak every week. So those are users that are actually valuable. They're coming back every week. They're providing something to the community. And once you choose your right metric, you have to focus on growing only that. And that leads to my third point, which is stay focused. And this will sound very ironic because I'm here today, but I generally avoid going to conferences, startup events, networking events, happy hours. Those don't make your product better, and those don't grow your core metric. So I would really encourage people to avoid going to those events. Just no amount of networking will get your product better. What will get your product better is you working on your startup, talking to users, and trying to grow your metric. And once you grow and you have an amazing growth graph, you won't need networking. Well, and then that leads to the fourth point, which is if you have to stay really focused, of course you're gonna start small. And it's okay to start small as long as you think big. When I was pitching Beak, and I love that they put this image here, I was pitching Beak as a social network for book lovers. That's like the worst idea you could ever hear. And like even an investor told me, this is the most stupid idea I've ever heard. You know, but that's how it started. We started saying, we're gonna dominate books. We're gonna make every Latino be obsessed about books. And just every Latino who wants to read is gonna come to our site. And we're starting on that, but now our vision is way bigger, right? We wanna become the Amazon of Latin America. So it's okay to start small as long as you think big. And well, I just wanna finish up by saying thank you to Josh, Bob, Ben, and everyone in the Longhorn Startup Lab, my mentors, Damon is over there too. There's no way Beak would have started without Longhorn Startup Lab. We're definitely just starting and we're not even close to success yet, but I think Longhorn Startup Lab really put us in the right direction to start. So thank you very much.
There we go. Great. Well, that was really wonderful. Thank you, Pamela, for coming out to share that with us. And you know, when I asked her to do this, there was a point where she looked at me and, or I don't know, she looked at me. It might have been over email or over the phone, but she said, "Why do any of them want to hear from me? I haven't been successful yet." And I looked at her and I was just like, "They all want to do exactly what you just did. You're crazy. Of course they do." And I think you all see that now. So thanks again to Pamela. All right, well, next up, we've got two really great speakers, Bob Metcalf, who helped start this class. Bob is going to be interviewing Crystal Glanchai. I'm going to let him do the intro for her, but I get to do Bob, and I'm so happy to do that because I've gotten to spend so much time with him, and I feel so fortunate of that and for Austin and for UT and for all of us. Bob came here back in 2011. That was when we started the class. I was really lucky to be one of the first people he met, and fortunately, before he started a class with somebody else, I got to tell him about the class that we were working on, and we got to pull him in to help us get this started. And I don't know where Longhorn Startup would be today if it weren't for Bob. Bob was early on was a researcher where he came up with a few other people with the technology for Ethernet, for the cord and the protocol that connected the first computers together. And through that, created a company called 3Com, which ended up selling for billions of dollars to HP. One of the things I love about Bob is he'll talk about how he has a new career every 10 years. And so he was a researcher, then he was a CEO, then he became a publisher and a writer at InfoWorld, one of the top technology pubs of the time. He did that for 10 years. Then he became a venture capitalist at Polaris in Boston and invested in a whole bunch of companies. And after that, we got him, and he came down here to Austin now, I guess, about 6 years ago. So that means technically we've got about 4 years left. So we better make the best of it. And when Bob came to Austin and when he came to UT, it really, you could feel just the entrepreneurial energy just ratchet up a whole notch. And since then, he's just become the icon of entrepreneurship for everything here at UT. And if anybody wants to know what's going on with entrepreneurship or the coolest startups or anything going on, Bob is the guy to go talk to. And one of the things that I really appreciate about him, and aside from the fact that his next career could possibly be as a comedian, is the way that he interacts with all the students here. I feel like in many ways we get to do the good cop, bad cop thing, and he's the good cop, I'm the bad cop. I'm usually the one with the bad news, but I'm just amazed with how encouraging and supportive he is of every startup and every entrepreneur that he meets with and every student. And he just has an incredible grace and patience that he brings to it that we all really benefit from. So I'm gonna welcome Bob out, and he's gonna introduce Chris Dahl, who's gonna be interviewing, and thank you so much, Bob, come on out.
Well, thank you very much. What a great gig I have tonight. I get to welcome back to the 40 Acres, one of our former students, and introduce her to you. And her full name is Dr. Luz Cristal Sanchez Glanchai.
Yes.
But she's given me permission to use a shorter version of her name, Dr. Cristal.
Sure. Let's do it.
And she's a scientist, an entrepreneur, a mentor of entrepreneurs, and with a special interest in girls and teaching them about technology and entrepreneurship. She's a Plan 2 graduate, a Bachelor of Science in Mechanical Engineering, an MS and a PhD in material science, I guess.
Then
you got the two certificates on top of the degrees, a couple of certificates in nanotechnology and imaging.
Yes.
Now, let's start at the beginning. Are you ready? Hello? You there? So I had drinks.
The first time we met, yeah.
With Cristal's dad for a couple hours over there across the river. But we never got around to talking about you and growing up. Could you just tell us a little bit about how you grew up?
Yeah, sure. I'm a native Austinite. I don't think there's many of us left here in Austin. There might be. And so my dad's actually from Mexico. He was in the Olympics for wrestling, and he was also on the soccer team there. Saved up enough money to come and study here at UT, where he met my mom on the steps of Gregory Gym. So he was actually taking modern dance, and my mom was taking archery. And that's kind of how I came about. But I spent most of my time, most of my summers in Mexico, with my dad teaching us to change the oil in cars, change the engines, change tires. If we wanted a dollhouse, he actually had us build it ourselves. And then just spent the rest of my time doing school here in Austin.
All right, so you just heard Pamela Valdez talk about dropping out of, what'd she say, pause? She paused. So a lot of people, what was that? Drop out? Yeah, she dropped out of school, and that's pretty common. As you know, all entrepreneurs drop out of school. But you didn't, you got not one degree, but you got 4 degrees from UT, and then those certificates that we mentioned. Why did you do that?
I don't know, it's really interesting. I love learning, and ever since I was young, I've always loved new technology and kind of thinking about what is the technology of the future. So I think after I did my engineering degree here at UT, I went to 3M, and I was designing copper connectors for automated test equipment. Not super fun. And
she went to 3M, which is not the same as 3Com. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and so 9/11 happened, and I started to ask myself, you know, how am I helping people? What am I really doing to help society? I didn't really see how, like, making this little, I mean, it's really like the plugs that you plug into the wall. That's what I was designing. So I started taking biology and chemistry classes at night. I had heard about genetic engineering and Dolly the sheep, and I just wanted to be involved in that. Like, I wanted to invent something new. So I thought going to get my PhD was the best way to do that, because as you know, as a PhD student, a doctoral student, you're creating new knowledge. You're creating something that didn't exist before, that you actually can't go out and ask other people. You have to go out and do the research and figure it out yourself. So my kind of idealistic goal was that I wanted to find a cure for cancer. So came back to school, used a little bit of my mechanical engineering background, and then...
But didn't you go to ACC for a while?
So that was while I was at 3M, I took classes after work at ACC. So I took biology and chemistry classes, because I didn't have the background necessary to go into biomedical engineering, and my parents thought I was crazy, because I took the classes and then I quit my job and went back to get the PhD.
And then somewhere along the line, you met Professor Nichols?
Yes, so as a grad student, I had been working on my technology, which was, it was basically size and shape specific nanoparticles that would preferentially target lung cancer tumor tissues. So you would reduce the side effects in cancer patients. And I took a class with Dr. Nichols, it was a technology commercialization class. And that's where I really learned the importance of applying what you're learning in school to create products and services that can benefit society. So I actually wanted to commercialize these nanoparticles that I was making to actually become a product to help cancer patients.
And then your startup was NanoTaxi?
Yes, NanoTaxi.
It's like an Uber thing?
Well, yeah, so the idea was that it would take the drug where it needed to go. It wasn't going to take detours throughout the body. It was preferentially going to target and go directly where it needed to go.
Did the drugs have to be fingerprinted?
No.
No. Did you... So then you ran into a group called Springboard. Can you tell us about that?
Yeah, so I was looking for mentors as I was starting this company, and I ended up meeting Becky Taylor. So she actually served as my, interim CEO while I was the CTO, and she got me involved in something called Springboard Enterprises, which is a group for high-growth, women-led companies. So she got me involved with that group, and I went out and started doing investor pitches in New York and San Francisco, trying to pitch this drug delivery company and raise money for human studies.
And out of all that, you came up with this cool acronym, ESTEEM.
Oh, so that's actually with Venture Lab, so that's something different.
Let's hold off on that,
yes.
Then. We'll get back to that later. So what did you learn from your startup?
It's a lot more work than you think, and going out, it's really tiring to go out and, you know, go and do these pitches and constantly, you know, flying and trying to pitch different people on your idea. I think it was hard, too, trying to learn, like, you had to take everything with a grain of salt. And I think as a student at the time, I wasn't quite sure, like, who do I listen to? Because this investor is saying this investor is saying something else. And just really trying to get your own compass and believing in yourself of, okay, I know this is the right direction. And just continuing on with that belief that you have and following that direction, but still taking advice at the same time.
So you repeatedly use this interesting expression called entrepreneurial mindset or entrepreneurial learning.
Yes.
That seems to be one of your big takeaways from all this. What is that?
So I think, for me, entrepreneurship isn't just about starting a company. I think a lot of people, when they hear entrepreneurship, they think startups and companies, but I don't think it's just that. It's having a specific mindset. So not being afraid to try something and fail, persevering, taking risks, being confident in yourself, believing in yourself. So I think there's a mindset that entrepreneurs have. But even more so, it's also a skill set. You know, how do you take an idea and turn it into a product and then turn it to a company? So there's a skill set that I think you can teach, which is, okay, you have an idea. How do you figure out it's an opportunity? You go out and do your market research. So talking to people, making sure that there actually is a market for your product, coming up with your business model, and then pitching. So I think the skill set and mindset you can teach to anyone. I think, you know, if you're an artist, you're going to have to be entrepreneurial. Like if you're going to have your own studio or market your art, if you're a doctor and you have your own practice, if you're a musician, I just really think we are all very entrepreneurial, but we don't know it.
So you took this learning to Trinity.
Yes.
You were there for 3 years. So what did you do there?
So Trinity wanted to start an entrepreneurship program, and they brought me in. So Trinity is a university in San Antonio. It's a liberal arts university. And so it's got a ton of liberal arts students, and they wanted to show the liberal arts students that entrepreneurship was for them. So we basically created a bunch of programming. I taught intro to entrepreneurship, entrepreneurial finance, creativity, design thinking, and then worked to start some incubators, so Geekdom in San Antonio, building the entrepreneurial community, because it was kind of really scattered at the time, and just kind of building an entrepreneurial ecosystem.
San Antonio is south of here?
Yes.
Yeah.
And when the Hyperloop is built, it's only going to take 8 minutes to get there. I'm excited.
So now, coming up to today, you have this activity called Venture Lab, which you've started a while ago. What's that about?
Yeah, so I'd always noticed as an engineer at 3M, as the CEO of NanoTaxi, going out to do investor pitches, I just noticed the lack of women. Like, where were the women leaders in technology? Where were the women CEOs? Where were the women investors? And even at Trinity, my hope was that I would get girls into my entrepreneurship classes, and I also taught some engineering as well, but it was hard. It was like pulling teeth to get the girls to come into my classes. And I would ask them, and it was like they had already lost the confidence. Like, if they were getting a C in the class, whereas a guy in computer science would say, hey, I'm getting a C, it's no big deal, the girls would come to me and say, I'm dropping out, I'm getting a C. It was like they felt like they had to be perfect. And I realized that I needed to start at a younger age. So I wanted to start at age 5, even before girls got into kindergarten, to show them and give them the confidence that, one, they could take an idea, turn it into a product, and start a company. So that,
at age 5?
Yes.
Okay.
We have had 5-year-olds start companies. We actually had a 13-year-old who was passionate about obesity. So she created an app where the more walking you did, it unlocked points in her app and gave you tickets to museums around San Antonio. So she was 13 and she raised about $250,000.
Did she use JavaScript or?
You know, I'm not the app tech person, so I'm not actually quite sure what she used.
And now, coming out of Venture Lab, you have a new project that will appear in 2018. Tell us about your book.
Oh, so can I say something before the book?
Excuse me?
So with Venture Lab, sorry, I want to continue on with that really quick. So right now with Venture Lab, what we do is we provide youth entrepreneurship curriculum to students. So we're in 35 schools across Texas and California, and we're working to democratize entrepreneurship. So we're putting our curriculum online for free in bite-sized chunks so that parents, teachers, Girl Scout groups, and everyone can have access to learning the entrepreneurial mindset.
Excuse me for not letting you finish the Venture Lab thing, but it sort of leads right into Venture Girls.
Yes.
Tell us about that.
Well, Venture Girls is coming out spring 2018, actually April 2018. I didn't realize how long it takes to write and publish a book because I started writing in 2015. But it's basically how we create more confident girl leaders by teaching them the entrepreneurial mindset. So it's kind of my experiences teaching girls throughout Venture Lab. It's my experiences interviewing successful women entrepreneurs and CEOs and really kind of figuring out what are those things we need to teach our daughters so that they can become confident leaders.
Thank you. So now, coming right up to today and your return to the 40 acres, a couple of deans, Brent Iverson of Undergraduate Studies and the VP of Research, Dan Jaffe and others, Isaac Barkas, raised $1 million from this fund called the Blackstone Fund. And with that momentum, managed to recruit you to come and lead the Blackstone launchpad. Tell us what that's about.
Yeah, so the idea with the Blackstone Launchpad is it's an interdisciplinary campus-wide program for undergrads, grads, faculty, and staff. And the whole idea with UT is that there are a lot of entrepreneurship groups on campus, and we're trying to work with all the entrepreneurship groups to create a place where we can all know where to go. If you have an idea, where do you go if you have an idea? What if you already have a startup? What classes are going on? So we're going to be able to provide mentoring to students. So starting the fall, it doesn't actually start till the fall. So one-on-one mentoring with students. So whether you just have an idea, maybe you're a liberal arts student, you don't know what entrepreneurship is, just coming in to find out, what can I do? What are the next steps? Where can I go? We're going to offer workshops for students in entrepreneurship and commercialization, as well as workshops for faculty. We're going to be starting an undergraduate business plan competition. We will also be starting a women's incubator program to fund women-led companies out of UT. And also something interesting that I wanted to announce that Blackstone just told us is that we've got a partnership with Techstars. So students pitching tonight have the ability to, we're going to send two students up to New York to participate in a Techstars program, all expenses paid. So that's pretty exciting. But I think it's a really great way to really get everyone involved in entrepreneurship.
So how do we get this trip to New York?
So August 1st, it's going to be announced, and student groups from UT can actually apply for it.
Okay. You've skipped over a really important thing. For years, as Josh can attest, we've been creating spaces on campus for students interested in entrepreneurship, and we've had down on Guadalupe, and we've had in the chemistry building, and so on. And you have managed to do something that we all thought was impossible involving the FAC. Could you tell us about that?
Yeah, so our space is in the Flawn Academic Center, so right in the heart of campus. What Blackstone noticed when they came down to fund us is that they walked through the entire campus and they couldn't find the word entrepreneurship on any building or anywhere visible to the public and to students walking by. So part of the grant was that we actually had to have a physical space in the center of campus. And the idea is also that this is one of the Flawn Academic Center is one of the most heavily used spaces. It's got students from all disciplines coming in to study, to meet. So we really wanted to have a centralized spot where students can come in, exchange ideas, brainstorm. So we've got lots of whiteboards, lots of wall space for people to come and write on the windows. But the idea was just really to provide a centralized spot for everyone to come in and start exchanging ideas, talking about startups and working together.
You're understating how centralized this is. I mean, it's not on the fourth floor, and it's not on the third floor, and it's not on the second floor. You know that place you go to register, the FAC? Right in the middle of that is this space. So I think the we're done. Our work is done here now. We have a centralized space. So would you care to invite the crowd to participate in what you're doing in some sort of way?
Yeah, so in the fall, we're going to be officially launching. So for the community, we're actually looking for mentors who are going to want to help us serve office hours in the space. We are actually hiring student ambassadors as well. But we really want students who are in any stage of entrepreneurship or have an idea to come and talk to us. And we can help advise you. And actually, one of the things, too, about Blackstone is we have access to some of Blackstone's resources. So funders from across the U.S. And an online platform with resources and tools that can help you with starting your company.
I've taken the liberty of writing down your email address, which is lcglanchai, G-L-A-N-G-C-H-A-I, at austin.utexas.edu. Is that correct?
Yes.
And people should feel free to use that email address to hook up with what you're doing?
Mm-hmm.
So let me... LC Glanchai.
Yeah. Feel free to email me.
So now I'd like to ask you all to join me in welcoming Dr. Kristal back to the 40 acres.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Well, great. So now we are going to take a short 10-minute break. Like I said, I'd encourage you to meet your neighbor, find out who else is around here. If you want to learn more about LE or Genesis, come down here. After the break, we've got 12 student startups. They're going to pitch all rapid fire, so it'll take about an hour. And then we will award the $5,000 prize and have the big announcement. Startup pitches? Great. I think you are going to be really blown away when you see what these student entrepreneurs have accomplished. We see pitches all the time from startups of all different stages, Capital Factory and all over, and I'm always blown away by how well these students present what they're working on and how amazing it is what they're really doing. There's a pretty broad range of companies across all kinds of different industries and targets. There are some that are consumer products, some that are targeted at businesses. All of them are real. They've got real things they're working on and real products they're building. Most of them have gotten some kind of customer dollars in. They've got some real customers or have gotten some payments. But one thing you'll notice about the order is the three at the end are the ones that have made the most money, that are really making money. And we're going to award a prize at the end of $5,000, a $5,000 grant that was really exciting. That's a new part of the program this year that's been made available through a generous donation. And students also each received a $1,000 grant at the beginning of the semester to kick things off. The $5,000 grant is going to go to the team that has accomplished the most over the semester. And but part of that requires they have to be making money. And so it's going to be one of the last three. So stay tuned. You want to see those last three. Both are the ones making the most money. And at the end of that, we'll have our special big announcement, and then we'll award that $5,000 prize. We'll wrap all that up by 9 o'clock at the latest, but I think before then. And then we're heading over to Spider House for the after party, which is you could walk there. Otherwise, it's just kind of just north of campus. And hopefully you can join us there, too. So these are all rapid fire. They're about 5 minutes each. Each time a startup's an entrepreneur or a student's going to come out, they're going to give their pitch right here, and it'll just go right from one startup to the next. So we're going to jump right into it, and the first startup is AirDrum. Take me down to the paradise city where the grass is green and the girls are pretty.
Hey, everyone. Can everyone hear me? Yeah. OK, good. Hey, everyone. My name's Tavish, and I'm the founder of AirDrums, the world's first truly portable drum set. Sorry. So live demos are hard, so cut us a little slack. There was a little, so we all have those moments. We're lying down in our bedroom, listening to our favorite song, wearing our favorite pajamas, and the beat starts kicking up, and we reach over to our desk, grab two pencils, and then we start acting like we're air drumming. And for some of those people, that's what inspires them to start drumming. And they're like, you know what, okay, let's go get a drum set. And so let's say they take the initiative, they go over to their local drum store, and they quickly find there are three main problems when you're trying to buy a drum set. The first one is they're pretty expensive. They start around $500, and for most of us, that's quite a bit to invest in a hobby. The second is they're pretty loud. Drums are by far the loudest instrument, and we all know our neighbors are not going to like that. They're also pretty large. Drums take about a third of the average room size, so if you live like in an apartment or a dorm, it's just not going to fit anywhere. So how big is this market to begin with? Well, our product is really unique in that we feel like it fits into multiple market segments, including the educational market, where we can have an affordable tool for students to practice and learn how to play the drums, as well as the acoustic and educational market, where we can have our product to track and instantly record digitally whatever they play, like any beat or song that they perform. So what is AirDrums? AirDrums is a Bluetooth wearable device that you strap onto your drumsticks and your feet. We use 3D motion sensors to map out a drum set right in front of you so you can play anywhere, anytime. We also have an app that allows you to customize exactly where you want each drum to be located, so you can drag and drop your snares here, your cymbals here, and so on. Air Jones is built with the latest in embedded technology. It's Bluetooth ready, so it connects to your smartphone or your computer really easily. It also is MIDI enabled. MIDI is the standard protocol that electronic instruments talk. So you can easily use GarageBand, Logic Pro, or any other music production software that you already use. Our product integrates directly into any of those. So what are the competitors right now? Well, first of all, there's the traditional drum set, of course, and then there's also camera or VR-based solutions. The problem with camera or VR is that you have to place a camera like 10 to 15 feet in front of you, you have to be in certain lighting environments, and just this really big hassle to set it up every time. With air drums, it's hyper-portable. You can take it anywhere, simply connect to your smartphone via Bluetooth or your computer, and you can just start jamming. So it's literally zero setup time. And it's also really affordable. It costs $100 for 4 modules. So our current go-to-market strategy is to do an Indiegogo campaign this summer, where we expect about 3,000 pre-orders. Once we fulfill those pre-orders, we are then looking for strategic and targeted distribution vendors like Amazon and Guitar Center for the following year. So the Air Jones leadership team, we were composed of tech founders as well as music advisors, and we feel like our combined experience in designing consumer wearable products along with the domain expertise in the music scene allows us to build a high quality product to solve this big problem. And that's Air Drums. We're launching on Indiegogo this summer, and we hope you continue to support and back us. Thank you.
One, two, three, My baby don't mess around because she loves me so, and this I know for sure.
Hi guys, I'm Pavel from Street Spin. I can't dance as well as Bob Metcalf, so I didn't even try it. So I'm Pavel from Street Spin, and we believe that kids learn a heck of a lot more when they're having fun. So what's the problem that we're trying to solve? This is what the problem looks like. Increasingly, kids are disengaged and bored in the classroom. This is happening because kids expect visually rich experiences, such as Minecraft or YouTube, experiences that are competitive, experiences where they get real-time feedback and they're in control. So at Street Spin, we're taking those qualities of collaborative, competitive, visually rich, real-time feedback, kids are in control, but we're trying it in the classroom. So what does that look like? So we're trying this right now in Gus Garcia Middle School in Northeast Austin, and we're seeing incredible results for engagement and kids having fun and not being bored. So much so that the kid, this is Jamillion on the left, and this is Jason on the right. And Jason was getting so excited playing our game when the rounds were over that he would slap Jamillion's arm. Do you guys see the problem with that, though? Do you guys see the problem? Jamillion's got a broken arm. And I mean, I was watching this from the corner. I mean, it was round after round. When they would win those rounds, he would just slap him, and Jamillion would just cringe in pain. So at that point, we kind of knew that there's something there. And Jamillion would go, hey, stop it. But they would keep going. So what are they doing that's this much fun? Or how does Street Spin work? So teacher goes to streetspin.com, and they're able to choose a lesson or create their own lesson. So let's say, in this case, the teacher chooses European landmarks. A European landmark, round one, will begin, and it will go up on a large screen just like this in the classroom where the students, let's pretend you guys are the students, you guys will pull out your mobile devices and you will compete to identify this location. So just out of curiosity, how many of you guys know this location? Just raise your hand, I'll be impressed. One, two, okay, great. So we don't expect the kids to know that right away, so what are the kids doing during this time? So step number one, the kids all have devices. They log in, they join the game, and they get that location on their mobile device. But the key part is they're able to zoom, look left, look right, look for contextual clues to where they are. So you can see this child found the Anne Frank house. So they figure out where it is. And step number two, they hit make answer, they get a map, and they drop a pin on a map that they're able to zoom where that location is. 100 seconds later, the round ends. The green flag is the correct answer, the Anne Frank house. The icon on the bottom is where the child dropped their pin, and their distance is what dictates the score. The closer the child is, the higher their score. So why is this so powerful, and why is this so engaging and important for the kids? And the one thing, the important thing that I skipped over, the results also go on a big leaderboard on the big screen. That's why those kids are slapping each other and having fun, because they're getting acknowledgement from their peers. This is so powerful because kids are learning from experience. They're navigating the location. So this is, again, Gus Garcia. This was the location. This is near the Red Square in Moscow. And I look over at two kids who are playing, and they're absolutely perplexed. And I know why they're perplexed. About 10 seconds later, one of the kids jumps up and goes, "Oh my God, these letters are not like the letters in our alphabet." And you can see that N's are reversed in Cyrillic. That's actually the letter I. And that moment was so powerful that the teacher paused the game and went over the existence of Cyrillic, Arabic, Latin, and all these other languages. Those kids didn't know about Russia or Cyrillic 100 seconds when that round started. They did at the end. The second most powerful part is the kids are problem solving using technology. In this case, that was the location, and halfway through the round, the clue is Hunchback of blank blank. Inevitably, the kids know. They go, "It's Notre Dame." But remember, they need to drop a pin on Notre Dame. So what would you do if you didn't know where Notre Dame was? You'd Google it, right? Because the kids, they're playing in a team and they have multiple devices. When they Google Notre Dame, what do they inevitably get? They get the university. So now they're confronted with this predicament. They see the cathedral, they see the university. They're two different things, and you can see them kind of spinning their wheels talking. Inevitably, one of the kids will say, "Why don't we add cathedral to the end of the Notre Dame Google search string?" So they're going through all these steps. Which side of the road are cars driving on? What's the language? Is that a pagoda? What's the architecture? So it's really about this contextual problem solving as a team. So as far as traction, and let's talk about traction first. We have three schools using this right now. Austin ISD, the teacher's name is James Brewster. His comments is, when kids play this, they engage more than they engage. That day, they engage more than they engage all year. We have a teacher, Rebecca Robinson, from St. Louis, using this in her classroom. She said when the kids came back from spring break, the first thing they said is, "When could we play street spin?" We have a teacher, Tees, who's out in Amsterdam, using this with his kids. He's creating his own lessons, so there's user-generated content. As far as a revenue model, we're working on that right now. We have a couple options, maybe a freemium model, so we're trying to figure that out. We're live right now. We're doing zero marketing. If you're a teacher, if you want to play this at home, you launch it at streetspin.com, or if you have any questions or like to contact us, streetspin.com, there's a contact feature. Thank you.
Y'all, can you hear me? All right. Oh, the music started. Okay. Hey, y'all. My name is Daniel Miaris, and I'm a member of the desk team, where we're creating the homework solving sandbox. Now, to illustrate that, I want you to meet Chase. Now, Chase is an electrical engineering student here at UT, and like every STEM student all across the country, he carries his heavy textbook on his back both ways, and he does his homework 8 hours a night the same way it's been done for 1,000 years. He has a pen, a paper, and a textbook that have all been around for 1,000 years, and a calculator, maybe that's been around for 50 years. Now, here's the problem he's trying to solve. He's got a circuitry that he's trying to figure out, very basic electrical engineering problem, and here's how he's gonna do it. He's gonna copy the textbook problem down onto his paper. He's gonna go to the calculator, do some calculations, go back to the paper, do a few more steps, go back to the calculator, make a few mistakes, go to the calculations, look, check his work on the laptop, he's gonna go to the textbook, make sure he copied it down, right, go back to the calculator, go back to the paper, do a few more steps, and then finally, maybe he'll get an answer that he's satisfied with. Now, that process isn't just dizzying. It's woefully cluttered, it's inconvenient, and it's error-prone. And most importantly, it hinders Chase's ability to learn. Now I want you to meet Desk. As you can see, Chase is copying down the problem onto his piece of paper by scanning it in on a photo, and then he's able to write down the math directly onto the paper. And what's really magical is right here. You're gonna see that he can directly write the math and it turns into something legible. But not only something legible, it's something that he can organize and then immediately get the answer for. Now, what we've done is contained all of the clutter in the previous workspace, and we've allowed him to augment his entire problem-solving workflow. Now, the best part of that is that Chase is only half of the equation. He doesn't learn alone. He learns with a teacher. Now, any teacher wants three things. He wants to meet students where they are. He knows that everyone has a mobile phone and that a lot of them have tablets, and he wants to be able to leverage that to help students learn. He wants to identify the stragglers before the damage is done. Of the dozens of professors that we've talked to, they all said that they want to know before people fail the first exam where they're messing up. And he wants to personalize students' learning according to their mastery of the material. So in a sense, what a teacher wants is desk. So how are we going to do that? The process is simple. We have students solving problems on our app, just like Chase, as you saw. And then we collect data based on how they're solving those problems. And as we do that, we aggregate it and we turn that into impactful insights for the professors and for the students so that we can say at the end of a problem set, here's where people are messing up and here's where you might be able to teach them better, completely augmenting the current learning workspace for students and for teachers. Now, don't just take my word for it and don't think it's just limited to Chase. We have 41 beta users right now, and we have 90% of the professors that we've talked to say that they would already accept homework that's turned in from desk. And also, without marketing and without the data collection platform that I was talking about, we've already had 3 people purchase our app in the past week. Now, to take a step back, we aim to make learning more efficient and more enjoyable for STEM students and STEM educators. And our team is perfectly poised to do just that. Cage Johnson is in the audience right now. He's our founder and an electrical engineering student himself. And the rest of our development-heavy team is all has firsthand experience with just how much homework sucks. And we're all motivated to change that process. Now, our competitive landscape is actually quite favorable to us. I'm sure a bunch of you in the audience have been thinking about Notability and OneNote throughout this pitch. But the thing is, they don't do what we do. They're not centered around the STEM use case. We have modular problem solving, and we have calculations in a way that they don't. So we know that we're competitively positioned moving forward. And the market that we're looking at is actually quite large. There are 250,000 STEM students in the US alone who have tablets, a number that's only going to grow as tablet usage increases in the classroom and as more and more students are driven towards STEM. Now, our business game plan is to capture that big number. And the way we're going to do that is we're going to launch in the fall with a redesign with more features when students are coming back to campus and they're willing to spend money on their learning workflow. But what we're really excited about is institutional sales, where we go college by college and give the app to these professors so that they can augment their entire workflow and so that we can generate a sustainable revenue stream for desk. And in the near future, we want to look at licensing, where we go to content producers who already have good relations with the universities, and we say to Pearson and Scholastic and companies that are no longer competing on content, but are competing on how that content is presented and how students can interact with it to use our app. And don't just take my word for it. The CEO of Cengage Learning, a $2 billion company, said that digital learning has fundamentally changed every aspect of what they're doing with their content, meaning that desk has a significant opportunity to white label our product in the future. Now, long term in the edtech space, we know that it's the right time for tablets in the classroom, as usage increases nationwide and within the classroom. We know that it's the right time for big data in the classroom, for all the trends that have revolutionized how we interact with the world at large and information to come into the classroom. And in summation, we know that it's the right time for desk. It's the right time for us to bring the classroom into the 21st century where it belongs. Now, if that mission resonates with you, we'd love to have you reach out. My contact information is right there. Please feel free to visit our website at www.desk.education. Download it if you have an iPad, and we'd love to hear from you after the pitch. Thank you so much.
Before I introduce myself, I think it's only fitting that I introduce Steve. He's clearly having a rough day at work, but to understand why his day is so horrible, I have to go back to yesterday around 4 o'clock p.m. That's when the hiring manager came to Steve's desk and asked him, "Steve, would you mind staying for another hiring event after work?" You see, Steve is working for a large company that's growing really quickly right now. And in order for his company to succeed, he's an integral part of these hiring events. So of course, he obliges, texts his wife and tells her that yet again, he won't be home for dinner, and off he goes to the recruiting event. He met so many people at this event. It was a sea of faces. However, the following day when the hiring manager came to his desk and asked him, "Steve, did you meet anyone in particular who would be a perfect fit for our company?" Steve said, "I think I did, but I can't remember her name." And he began looking through the large stack of resumes, trying fruitlessly to find the candidate that he spoke with. If only he had a way to search by the qualities that he did remember about the candidate. For example, that she was a Longhorn and that she used to work at Dell. He would have instantly been able to recognize that it was in fact Samantha who he spoke with. This is not only a problem for Steve. This is a problem for companies overall. Companies currently spend up to 60% of their recruiting budget just on candidate sourcing. And when candidates cost between $3,000 to $12,000 just to hire, companies are potentially wasting thousands and thousands of dollars by not tracking data at the very first impression. Flow enables companies to make their recruiting processes more meaningful, more powerful, and personal from the very first touch point. Hi, my name is Catherine Allen. I'm the CEO and a co-founder of Flow Technologies, and we're here to change the way companies think about recruiting. We do this in three key ways. First, we allow employers and employees at recruiting events to search by anything they remember about a candidate. Steve, for example, can search by Texas and then quickly swipe through all of the candidates that match that description. Here, he instantly identifies that it was, in fact, Samantha who he spoke with. Then, he can provide instant feedback via his mobile device. This ensures that Samantha is marked as a top candidate and that she does not fall through the cracks in the hiring process. Then, all that feedback is stored in one place so that the recruiting team can instantly identify the top candidates and move them on in the hiring process, decreasing time to hire and confusion within the recruiting process. However, we know this industry is so big. However, we are confident that it is ripe for disruption. That is because companies, 2 out of 3 of them, are currently searching for a new applicant tracking system, because the ones that they currently have are only tracking processes, not engaging people and managing talent. However, this is a $29 billion market, as you see behind me, and in order to be successful in it, we knew that we had to start small. We had to start with a use case that we understood, and that was Greek fraternity recruitment. I know, believe it or not, fraternities actually have some of the same problems that companies do. They have trouble engaging candidates at that first impression, that first touch point. This is actually our first customer. They loved Flow so much that they renewed immediately after they used it. And fraternities just like these have recruiting budgets of up to $100,000. Now, yes, we know that a large percentage of that does go to beer, but we do believe that Flow can take a large portion of that as well. In just 1 month, we secured over 275 paying customers, and they're currently paying an average annual fee of $315 just for our beta product. We're currently operating with a contribution margin of $157. However, like I said, we're really excited about the successes we've been having in the fraternity space, but we're even more excited about the successes we will have in the broader market. That's why we've already begun talking to local Austin businesses. For example, we had a conversation with Kelsey Press from Trendkite. She told us that Trendkite is ready to use Flow at their next recruiting event. Then we talked to the chief marketing officer at Indeed, Paul Darcy. Paul told us that this industry is ripe for innovation, it's ripe for disruption, and he believes that Flow can play an integral part. Lastly, we spoke with Gerardo Interiano from Google. And when he heard about Flow, he immediately introduced us to the head of recruiting events, because even Google has these problems. This is our rock star team. With backgrounds in engineering, economics, and finance, we are perfectly positioned to take these problems on. Plus, employees and companies are trying to recruit our generation of millennials, which is the largest generation to enter the workforce since baby boomers. And we understand how our peers want to feel during recruiting processes. So you may be wondering at this point, what's our game plan? We've actually decided to end of life our fraternity business in favor of focusing all of our time in the broader market. Our goal is to have 4 early adopters by fall 2017 testing our product in their own recruiting processes. And in order to do that, we're currently raising $50,000. If you're interested in joining the Flow team and learning how companies can recruit better across the nation, we encourage you to come meet us at our table because we'd love to talk to you. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Jack Stingline. I'm a developer with ShopViews, which provides visual reviews for fashion retailers. Today, I'd like to talk to you about the fashion e-commerce industry. Now, I know what you're thinking. You're looking at my extremely stylish outfit here, and you're wondering, this is the guy who's going to teach me about fashion? Well, I did say I was a programmer, and for us, this is the height of fashion. Anyway. Anyway, stick with me for a moment, and I know you'll be excited about what ShopViews is doing. So more than $63.5 billion of clothing is sold online each year. Fashion e-commerce is huge, but the industry is not without its flaws. 48% of all that clothing is just sent back to the retailer, and 41% of online shoppers regularly buy more than one size of the same item, just to return what doesn't fit. ShopViews solves these problems for both the customer and the retailer through our unique product reviews plugin that goes above and beyond the standard 5-star review. Let's say a shopper, we'll call her Amy, orders a dress online. The store sends her the dress, and after she receives it, ShopViews will send her a feedback form. This feedback form is customized for the retailer and sent directly to Amy's email. It asks her how the item fit, what she liked about it, and what size she would normally wear for that type of item. She can also upload a picture of herself wearing the item if she chooses. At the end, she can claim either a discount or a loyalty reward. This data is then compiled into the ShopViews plugin, which is displayed along with an item on a retailer's website. At the top, we can see that this item has a 70% satisfaction rate. We can also see whether the item runs too large, true to size, or too small. At the bottom, we can see that Amy has left a review. She purchased a size 2 dress, weighs 130 pounds, and described her body type as athletic. She also said the dress fit her perfectly. The next user who matches Amy's dimensions can use her review to pinpoint the size of dress they should buy. These reviews are helpful to the consumer, but what makes them so compelling is that they come from real people. Recent research shows that user-generated content, especially pictures, are a good indicator of brand quality to 86% of millennials. Retailers who put user-generated content on their websites are setting themselves up for a brighter future. In fact, we took our inspiration from Rent the Runway, which provides high-end dresses for special events. They implemented a review system similar to ShopViews and saw a 200% increase in the likelihood of a dress rental if that dress had a user's image displayed alongside a model's. Rent the Runway is now known for their great review system, which is a huge reason for their success. ShopViews is making their success available to all fashion retailers. Our strategy is to target the existing e-commerce platforms of fashion retailers. We're starting as a third-party app on Shopify, one of the largest e-commerce platforms. Shopify has more than 300,000 merchants and has seen $29 billion in sales flow through its platform. By building an app for Shopify, we will be able to seamlessly integrate into these retailers' existing product pages. There are already some other Shopify review apps, such as Looks and Stamped. Looks provides pictures while Stamped sends email follow-ups, but neither are designed for clothing and lack the critical sizing features that make ShopViews a stronger option for fashion merchants. Now let's take a look at some of the numbers behind ShopViews. We operate on a tiered subscription model, ranging from $16 to $100 per month. Retailers can choose between the basic, plus, or pro tiers. As they move to the more advanced tiers, ShopViews will send more feedback forms to their customers. At the pro level, we also work with the retailer to match our plugin to the aesthetic and design of their website. We currently have two beta testers, ReDenim, a monthly subscription service for designer jeans, and CR Ranchwear, a Western apparel retailer. If you'd like to join our beta test or just connect with us in general, you can email team@shopviews.co. You can also follow us on the major social media sites using @shopviews. Thank you.
Can I kick it?
Yes, you can.
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 Well, I'm gone.
Hello, everyone. My name is Usher Malik, and I'm one of the co-founders of Kick It. We are a social app that helps connect people in the area with similar interests. If you think about how social has affected the internet, there are a lot of services that connect you to the people that you already know. Facebook, Snapchat, Instagram, Twitter. But there aren't many services that connect you to the people that you don't know. And that's exactly what we're doing. One of the hard things about making a mobile app is it's very difficult to get users. And so the question you should be asking us is, do you have users? Let's take a look at our weekly growth. This is week 1, week 2, 3, 4, and 5. As you can see, we have users all across the United States. And I actually checked for walking up here, and we're currently ranking on all social apps at 168. So we're really happy about that. But what is this app that people love so much? Let me introduce you to Kick It, a hyper-local social network. You can kind of think of this as Tinder meets Twitter, except we're not focused on dating. Whenever you sign up, the first thing you see is this page where you tell us what your interests are. We make this a fun little game to make it really easy. And once you tell us your interests, you get to go to the feed, which we cater just for you. We find other people in the area that have the same interests as you, and we show you those people. And then you can just have authentic conversations with them. Along with that, each person on Kick It has an awesome profile. So you get a bunch of pictures, you get their job, you get their school, you get their bio, mutual friends, and of course, your common interests. We've seen people use Kick It in a variety of different ways. People have come on here and grabbed drinks with each other. People have come on here and set up pickup games and played video games together. We've even seen people come on here and rant about their ex. So, people come here for emotional support, life advice, relationship advice. Honestly, the possibilities are endless. We classify our competitors into two categories, dating and friendship. But at the core, we are different because we operate more as a social network. What we have is a feed where our users can consume content, and none of these apps have that. And that's how we differentiate ourselves. So I would like to share a few key metrics with you guys. So we actually launched the app in the beginning of April, and since then we've had 10,000 users sign up, of which we have around 1,000 to 2,000 daily active users. Along with that, those users have made 22,000 posts, 25,000 comments, and here's the crazy part, 421,000 swipes on interests. And we're seeing heavy engagement. The median session length is 4 minutes, and our users spend an average of 2 to 4 sessions per day. So we're really happy with what we're seeing. How do we make money? So the digital advertising industry is projected to be around $335 billion by 2020. And we can play a part in this. So our users tell us their interests, and we can use this to show the right ads to the right people. An example would be, for example, deals. We've already seen people come on Kick It and say, hey, I want to go kayaking. Who's in? And this would be a perfect spot for us to insert an ad from a local kayaking rental shop for maybe 10% off. Along with that, we also put brands inside the cards our users swipe on. And so what we actually have is sentiment data organized chronologically and segmented by demographics such as age, gender, and location. And this is, of course, very valuable for brands to have. So the team currently is myself and my co-founder, Eric Ngo. We are both technical. I do the Android and the backend development, and Eric does the iOS development. And we both do marketing and everything else in between. We are currently raising a $200,000 pre-seed round. We're already a quarter of the way there, and we're going to use this money to get to 150,000 users. Along with that, we'll use it to cover server costs, legal costs, and, of course, payroll. So if you have any questions or if you just want to talk to us, feel free to reach out to myself. My email is usher@thekickitapp.com, and my co-founder's is eric@thekickitapp.com. We'll also be outside at our table, so if you want to come and swing by and talk to us, feel free. Thank you so much, everyone.
Hey everyone, my name is Alex. I'm here to tell you a little bit about my company, Nido Structures. Let's start off with a question. When was the last time you were able to really take a break from your job or your busy day at work? Now, I'm not talking about sitting down and browsing through your phone on Facebook or Twitter, but I'm talking about really relaxing. Maybe going outside on a day like today, laying down in the grass and feeling the sun on your face, listening to the wind rustling through the trees, just letting your mind be at ease and think about nothing. I had a problem when I came to UT. Austin's a really big place with a lot of people, and I found myself being overwhelmed by this from time to time. So when I came here, some friends and I started a club called Texas Hammocking. Really, the goal of it was to get outside, unwind, and make some new friends along the way. And we used a hammock as a vessel to do that. Just to give you an idea of what the club offered us, 2:15 in the afternoon, the bell rings, we get out of class, go outside. Within a minute, we could be hanging up in the trees, resting our eyes, or maybe talking to a friend about something interesting. 10 minutes later, we could pack down and still make it in time for next class. So it turns out that a lot of people really liked this idea. And as our membership grew, we eventually got a letter from the university telling us that we're not allowed to hang our hammocks on the trees anymore. I know, right? This is obviously a problem for us. And we did some more research, and we started to find out that the hammocks that we use nowadays, they have straps that you hang around the trees to secure them. And they're designed to be used in a forest, maybe where a tree sees one or two hammocks every year. But in an urban setting, we were taking multiple people, multiple hammocks, and hanging them all on the few trees several times a day. So what this can do is it can actually strip the bark off the trees and lead to the death of a tree. So we obviously didn't want that, and UT didn't want that. So it kind of sent us back into the dark ages of relaxation. We were forced to sit on the dirty couches at the PCL and lay in the itchy grass and even talk to our friends huddled around these boring things called tables. So after a while, we started to think, what if we didn't need the trees to hammock? That's when we came up with our solution, the Weaver. We took some decommissioned oil drilling pipe, which is bound for the landfill. We took it into the machine shop, cleaned it up a bit, welded it together, and turned it into a beautiful urban forest, perfect for hanging lots of hammocks on. We put our first prototype up on campus at UT, and people immediately fell in love. The Weaver, it has an open design, which promotes a social and a friendly atmosphere. You can come up and talk to your friend without feeling isolated. Not only that, but it's comfortable. It's the next best thing besides your bedroom to taking a nap in the afternoon. Whenever you lay in a hammock, you just feel like you're in a cocoon of happiness. In addition to that, the recycled materials that we use, before they were part of the Weaver, they were essentially trash. They were laying out in a scrapyard, just rusting away. And so we were able to turn them into something that people can actually enjoy. Lastly, it's way better than the alternative. I mean, let's be realistic. Would you rather sit on a park bench or hang in a hammock? After all this popularity on campus at UT, we eventually got recognition from a local company called Kamek. They're a hammock designer in Austin. And they ended up being our first customer. They wanted the Weaver for one of their events and offered to pay us in hammocks, which was great for us at the time. But what it did was it actually kickstarted the rental side of our company. Soon after, we figured out that we could charge real money for these rentals and people would pay them. So that's when we started taking the Weaver to different events, parties, corporate events, music festivals, breweries, things like that. Everywhere that we took it, people loved it. And we even went up with Kamek to a trade show in Utah last summer called Outdoor Retailer. That's when we met Ranger Eugene of the Utah State Park System. And he insisted on buying a Weaver for one of his parks. It was that point when we started to realize, hey, maybe this could be an actual company. So fast forward to today, we have over $20,000 in revenue, and our current customers include universities, summer camps, and state parks. There are thousands of these in the United States alone, and the Weaver allows us to tap into this pretty sizable market. Not only that, but future models and variations will help us tailor our products towards different scenarios. For example, maybe a hammock structure that folds down to the size of a duffel bag that you can take to the park. Or maybe one that's more permanent and that's designed to be cemented in the ground for playgrounds and office parks. I mean, imagine working at a place that had one of these in your backyard, in their backyard. I mean, wouldn't that be great? So going back to the original question, maybe the reason you don't take that 15-minute break in your afternoon is not because you don't have the time or not because you don't think it's beneficial, but probably because you don't have the place to do it. Here at Neato Structures, we want to give you that place. We want to bring the freedom of relaxation into your everyday life. So if you want to see the Weaver in action, after the event, go outside right by the fountain. We have one set up for you, so feel free to hang out in it. And if you know of a good place that could use a Weaver, come talk to me after the show. I'd love to chat. Thank you.
Okay, hello. I'm Daniela, and I want us to imagine something incredible. I want us to imagine that we are taking a trip to Brussels this summer. And in order for this to happen, we're going to need a few people to lead and coordinate the trip. Is anybody interested? I love the enthusiasm. It's a huge job. We have to make sure that everyone is safe and coordinated at all times. In fact, when we are in Brussels eating some Belgian waffles, someone has an allergic reaction to some peanuts in the waffles, and it is chaos. In order to deal with this, we have to think about a way to get this girl to safety as soon as possible, coordinate the rest of the team, and do this fast. But let's think about the situation for a minute. Our biggest problems here are that it's ineffective to communicate with such a big group. It is difficult to coordinate a group of this size, and ultimately, this is putting somebody's safety at risk. So in order to cope with this, we're gonna try to use two different methods. We are either gonna try to shout, which is ineffective, it takes a really long time to do, or we're gonna take our phones out and use a combination of different apps. Apps that are not made for traveling, but for socializing, so they don't necessarily work. So these solutions are not solutions at all. In fact, they perpetuate the problem, and that's a problem, but that doesn't stop us from traveling. In fact, we're traveling all the time. So my team and I created TripLoop, which is a solution. It is a tool that helps us travel with great passion and not stress. And this is a tool we are going to take to Brussels with us for three main reasons. TripLoop is made knowing that Wi-Fi and cellular connection is a luxury when you're abroad. So it's empowered with Bluetooth technology. And this way, we can always connect. Triploop knows that you need a closed social network for your team, one singular place where you go to communicate with your team, where you plan, share, and find all the information you need. Furthermore, Triploop has all the information of your trip that you need with you at all times. So as soon as you open the app, you're gonna see all the time, places, and locations, and where your group is. You can get lost, but you don't have to. We see a huge opportunity for Triploop because nothing like this exists. Groups are traveling all the time, and they are running into the same problems. So we created Triploop. And to give you an idea how big this industry is, this on top part of the industry is, we have the national available market at $4.3 billion for educational group travel. And for global group travel, it is $320 billion. To take advantage of this global opportunity we are in, we have a global team. In Canada, we have Javier, and he is our champion for the Mexican and Canadian market. In Spain, we have Diego, and he is our champion for our relations in Europe. And in Austin, we have our base camp, which consists of Diego, Mauricio, and I. And we are in charge of the American market. To enter the market, we have a business-to-business subscription-based model. For companies that move more than 1,000 travelers, we charge them $20 per traveler. And for companies that move less, we charge them $25 per traveler. We currently have beta testers in both of these categories, but I want to talk about API. This is their first sale, and this is a local company here in Austin that does trips for UT, so we are super excited. They move more than 3,500 students a year. They do more than 120 trips, and they go to more than 20 countries. Triploop is expanding naturally. So we see a huge opportunity. We have a great team, we have great timing, and a great product. Currently, we are raising $200,000 for the next year. And in the next year, we plan to do three major things. We are gonna launch our North American market, where we're gonna empower more than 200,000 travelers with our tool. We are gonna do extensive research on Bluetooth technology to expand our range and make it more reliable. And we plan to strategically partner with three big global players. And like with this, we plan to expand more. Now, I encourage you to talk to me if you are inspired in innovating group traveling with me. I am Daniela, and we are Triploop, and we are empowering you to travel with great passion and not stress. Thank you.
It's getting pretty thin, the water's getting warm, so you might as well swim. My world's on fire, how about yours? That's the way I like it, and I'll never get bored. Hey now, you're an all-star, get your game on, go play. Hey now, you're a rock star, get the show on, get paid.
So hello everyone, my name is David Groh. I'm a sophomore studying computer science here at UT, and I have a problem. It's a very serious problem. You might have this problem too. And the problem goes a little bit like this. It's a normal day, and I decide to check Facebook. And I see a selfie. So this happens to be my roommate. If you look in the background, there's the Eiffel Tower. So you know, here's my roommate taking this cool selfie in Paris, and I'm checking Facebook. And this isn't that big of a deal. But it seems to happen a lot. Later on, I go on Twitter, and I see another friend, and she's taking a selfie in front of this dinosaur thing. And later on, I'm just on the internet, not looking for anything, and I see this guy. At this point, it's like, what the heck? My life is not this interesting. I don't go to these cool places. I don't take selfies like this. So yeah, I thought about this problem, and I fixed it. So I'd like to introduce Selfie Anywhere. So Selfie Anywhere is an augmented reality app for taking cool selfies anywhere in the world. So let me show you how it works. So when you open the app, you have several locations to choose from. So you choose one that looks interesting. So here I'm going to choose Mars. And then the way it works is you can see yourself there in real time. So, and if it's not obvious, so it's a panoramic image. So as I move my phone, the background moves in sync, and I can position it just how I like, and I can take the selfie. It tries to clean it up any as it can. And of course, you know, now I have my selfie on Mars, and the first thing I want to do is share it. So I can, you know, hit the share button, choose a platform of my choosing, add a hashtag, of course. Hashtag selfie anywhere, it's essential. And there we go. Now I have my selfie on Mars, and I'm ready to share it with the world. So yeah, that's how it looks from a user's perspective. But how does it look like kind of behind the scenes? Because it turns out this is a pretty hard problem. Like, it's not enough just to do face detection or hope everybody has a green screen in their living room. You really requires a complex understanding of the image. Now, fortunately, people are spending millions of dollars on this research problem, not for selfies, but for stuff like self-driving cars. And in a self-driving car, you have a camera on the front of the vehicle, and it has to very quickly and accurately identify, okay, here are the trees, here's the car, here's the road, stay on the road. And it has to be this really quickly and accurately in order to safely operate. And it turns out this is just what you need to take a selfie anywhere. So what I've done is kind of taken some of these same techniques, retrained them and optimized them for mobile, and figured out how to render the background efficiently. And what I'm left with is some pretty state-of-the-art algorithms, also that way you or I can take some cool selfies. So, yeah. So I'm here to pitch a startup, not just, cool selfies. So a little bit about how this could make money. I think there's several ways, but I think the most interesting way is through sponsored locations. So you could imagine taking a selfie at a hotel brand or at the set of some movie that's coming out or in the showroom of a new product. And this is really great opportunities for advertisers because people are interacting with and sharing their brand. But it's also hopefully great for users because if they want to, they can be in these places they normally couldn't. So yeah, so some final thoughts about why I think this is exciting. The first is it's fun and social. And this might not seem like that big of a deal, but especially the social aspect, it's really important for reaching a lot of people. Second, augmented reality is growing a whole lot and very quickly. You have large companies investing lots of money in it, and it makes it a really great place to be as a startup. And finally, kind of what we're doing in augmented reality is a kind of a different approach. It's not putting things on top of your world, it's taking you out. And the technology and concepts developed as part of this are really important to other applications and future work. So yeah, so if you're interested, you can download the app. That's something I couldn't say 3 hours ago. So it was just released on the yeah, so really excited to finish that. You can literally be one of the first people to try it out. That also means that you can probably be the first ones to see it break. And when that happens, I'd really appreciate the feedback and how to improve, because I plan to continue and improve it. And kind of with that, if you're kind of interested in finding out more information and staying involved, you can follow us on Facebook or Twitter. Or anything else, you can reach me at david@selfieanywhere.com. Thank you.
Hey everyone, my name is Ahmed Raza, and we are transforming the world of website due diligence through rapid diligence. So every year, over 500,000 small businesses are sold across the US and around the world. Now, these are typically brick and mortar businesses such as small coffee shops and retail stores. But just like that, hundreds of thousands of web businesses or websites are sold across the world. Now, these are sites ranging from e-commerce sites to advertising sites and affiliate sites and so much more. Now, I've been personally buying and selling websites for the past 4 to 5 years. And when I'm interested in buying a site, I'll go to an established website marketplace such as Flippa.com. Now, on these website marketplaces, you'll find a wide variety of sites, both in terms of the price they're selling at and the amount of revenue they're generating, but also how they're generating that revenue. So let's say you're interested in buying a website. You'll go to one of these marketplaces, you'll look at all the websites for sale, maybe browse a couple of listings, and you'll come across one that catches your eye, such as popuptea.com. Now, on this listing page for popuptea.com, you'll find all the information you need about the business, starting from the website URL all the way to detailed financial information. Now, you're considering buying this website, and so the obvious next step is to start analyzing this data, a process more commonly known as due diligence. Now, the problem is that conducting due diligence for a website is a lot different than conducting due diligence for a typical brick and mortar business. And your due diligence checklist would look something like this. So very early on in the process, you'll realize a truth that a lot of website buyers realize, and that is that website due diligence is difficult. And that's exactly the problem we're solving. We're providing a software-based solution that takes hours of manual due diligence work and automates that in under 12 seconds. So you can think of us as a Carfax, but for websites. Let's see how it works. You go onto our platform and you input some basic information about the website, such as the website URL, the type of site it is, as well as the date the business was established. And then you provide us with some financial information about the website, which you would get from the listing page that we mentioned before. And then you generate the report. Now, when you generate your report, your rapid diligence report would look something like this. Now, I realize this is a lot to take in, so I want to focus your attention on a few key components. Firstly, our risk score. Now, our risk score is a number from 1 to 10 that tells you exactly how risky it is to buy this website. Now, doing this manually is a really tough task because you have to evaluate a lot of things. For example, how long has the website been around? How much revenue is it generating? Is that revenue growing or declining? Is this website in a high-risk industry? Is it PCI compliant? And then you have to take all of that, somehow compress it, and make sense of it. Well, not anymore. Because we take over 25 different components, we take over 25 different factors that are associated with risk, we compress them together, scale them based on our proprietary algorithms, and give you one comprehensive and consumable score that tells you exactly how risky it is to buy this website. Now, I know you're probably thinking at this point, does life get better than this? And the answer is yes, because we also provide you with a general criteria check, which is really our fancy way of saying we check for some of the main issues that are associated with most websites and see if that exists within the website you're considering buying. For example, a seller might claim that their website has been in business and has been established for the past 6 to 7 years. Now, the way to verify that manually would be to cross-check multiple databases and see if that is truly accurate. That would set you back anywhere from 30 minutes to a couple of hours. Once again, our software tests this and everything else in under 12 seconds. And lastly, we provide a suggested valuation, which is essentially a data-driven assessment of the website you're purchasing and its valuation. It's commonly known that when website buyers conduct hours of manual due diligence, they become fatigued and they'll often make offers that are based on impulse. Not anymore. Because with our suggested valuation feature, you can make an offer that is based on data and proprietary information, not just impulse. Now, I know at this point you're thinking where you can get access to this incredible piece of technology that we've put together. And I'm happy to tell you that all you have to do is go to rapiddiligence.com and sign up there. We'll get you started with a free trial so you can test out our software to your heart's content. Because we know that once you've experienced the world of automated website due diligence, there's just no going back. Once again, my name's Ahmed Raza, and this is Rapid Diligence. Thank you.
You're insecure, don't know what for. You're turning heads when you walk through the door. Don't need makeup.
How are you guys doing today? Good, good, good. I'm doing good too. So my name is Andy Shaw, and I love to sell stuffed animals. You might be wondering why the heck a grown man like me is selling plush toys, right? Well, a better question to ask is, how did I raise $50,000 on Kickstarter selling my plush toys? Well, first, thank you. First, we gotta backtrack a bit. And so last year, I wanted to start my own business, and my idea was a nosebleed plug. That's right. I asked Cheryl, who was my partner and partner, to join me, but she was like, ew, no. She wanted to create stuffed animals, and I agreed. Here's a cute picture of us. And so I noticed the teddy bear Cheryl kept laying on had lost shape over time. I thought long and hard until I realized that we can put memory foam cushion into a pillow-shaped plush, hence Memory Plush, our company's name. We envision our competitive landscape to be like this. You have most pillows and plush toys who don't retain shape or provide enough comfort. So we wanted to excel in these two areas. There's also a pet rock on there. They're durable, but they don't provide comfort. And so to test demand for this concept, we bought tiger plush toys. We cut memory foam mattress toppers into cushions and stuffed the cushions into the tigers. Here's the end result. And here's a picture of my bed. We had to sleep in the closet after this. And so we took the tigers to the domain to sell directly to parents and also consigned them in local toy stores. But sales were slow. We decided to build a brand from the ground up. And so over winter break, Cheryl reached out to our supplier and sent them design drawings. Here's one of her drawings. I know it's very simple, but she draws very well. And so after a couple back and forth emails, we had our first design. This is the moment we've been waiting for, guys. Everyone, I introduce you, Waffles, the memory foam corgi. You guys saw him earlier, but he is very popular. And so you might wonder, why did we create a corgi? Well, it's because they're very huge on social media. And we also named him Waffles to associate him with the popular food that everyone loves. You can't eat him, though. You can only cuddle with him. And also, you might wonder, what makes Waffles better than current plush toys? Well, I had to respond by saying, he is an irresistible loaf of bread that retains shape, is washable, and travel-sized. We put Waffles on our website, but guess what? Sales were slow, too. It was because customers wanted him now, and they couldn't. He was in pre-order mode. And so we reached out to a mentor from Startup Lab, and he mentioned we should use Kickstarter, and we did. You see, all of our spring break, we spent our time reaching out to Facebook groups, admins, and influencers. And speaking of influencers, do any of you know who this guy is? Anyone? That's right, that's Logic, a very well-known hip-hop artist. We didn't endorse him, but we sent a Waffles to his wife, and she ended up posting Waffles with her two corgis. This led to a lot of publicity before our campaign even begun. To generate even more, we posted our Facebook giveaway video in over 40 corgi groups. You can see that the engagement was pretty high. And so when our Kickstarter launched, we reached our $7,500 goal in 8 hours. But wait, we were hungry for more, so we attended corgi events. Cheryl, I'll show you guys in a bit. Cheryl really wanted to go to Los Angeles to attend Corgi Beach Day, and me being the great boyfriend I am, I agreed. And, and so when we got there, there was hundreds of corgis on this beach. Guys, it was like Coachella for corgis. Look at them. And so we had reached out to event organizers beforehand, and they allowed us to showcase Waffles. This led to even more brand awareness. And so we ended our Kickstarter journey with 1,065 backers, raising over $53,000. We'll be using this revenue to fulfill production, but also create more dog breeds so that all dog owners can get a Waffles resembling their pet. Do you guys get this joke? He sniffed a suitcase and he got, you know, he passed out from that. And so I would like to add, learning from mentors through this journey was very good, but fortune cookies work as well. Usually I don't take advices from fortune cookies because of stupid ones like this, but the one I ate recently said, hard work leads to luck. And that's the philosophy we're using to grow this business. Not yet? And so I hope you guys enjoyed our story. If you'd like to support us, you can adopt a Waffles. We are having 10% off for this event. If you go on our website, you can type in demo day in the checkout and you'll get 10% off. And we're also donating over $1,000 from our Kickstarter to Queen's Best Dumpy Dog Rescue, an amazing corgi rescue. Please visit us at memoryplush.com. Thank you, everyone.
Tell by my attitude that I most definitely leave from.
Hi everyone, my name is Walker Druitt and I'm a co-founder of New Wash Car Wash. New Wash is the easiest, most convenient way for you to get your car cleaned. And in fact, our customers never see us and never wait on us whenever we wash your car. We've actually got a lot of customers too. We've got 650 customers on our flexible subscription plan and have washed over 2,000 cars to date. But I'll tell you more about that success in a minute. First, I want to tell you why the car wash as you know it today really actually sucks. Right now, whenever you want a clean car, you have one of a couple really bad options. The first one being, you can take your car to the car wash and sit in the grimy waiting room for upwards of an hour while your car gets cleaned. And maybe you'll get some stale popcorn while you wait. Or you can take your car through the drive-through car wash that does an incredible amount of damage to the exterior of your car. And trust me, I've seen it firsthand. Not to mention, your interior isn't gonna get touched. But if you're like a lot of us in the room, you simply are very busy and don't have the time to go sit in the car wash for an hour while your car gets washed, and it's gonna end up looking something like this for quite a while. I feel that pain, and that's why we're here. We created New Wash as a flexible subscription car wash plan that lets you put your car washing on autopilot. We come to your apartment overnight or your office building while you're working and wash your car exactly where it's normally parked. And we're able to do that because we don't use much water. We use a plant-based polymer and water solution that does a phenomenal job at cleaning your car, is eco-friendly and biodegradable, and leaves absolutely no water runoff on the ground. You sign up on our website where you choose from a preferred exterior frequency of once or twice a month based on the size of your car. You can then choose to add your interior for $15 or a hand wax for $10, both of which can have their own individual frequency in case you don't want either of those every time you get your exterior washed. And being that we're a flexible subscription car wash, we schedule all of our customers at a particular building in advance and notify them when they're due for a wash, yet they still have the ability before that wash to skip it or pause their account for an extended period of time in case they're out traveling or simply just decide they don't want it that time. But how do we manage hundreds of customers across dozens of buildings with custom new wash packages and cars that can be parked literally anywhere? Well, I'll start with the fact that our core team of founders has washed the first 2,000 cars and counting, and we fully understand the intricacies in our service business. We've combined that on-the-ground experience with our backgrounds in technology to build a highly scalable back-end system that handles all of our customer communications and business logic. Our customers fully self-manage their new wash plan from their online member profile, where they can upgrade or downgrade their new wash plan, contact customer service, skip a wash, refer a friend, or do anything else that they need to do right at their fingertips. Just as importantly, we've used that on-the-ground experience to create a competitive and flexible job for our contract washers. We make sure that they have the right equipment and the right software tools so that they can earn upwards of $20 an hour before tips through our pay-per-car pay structure. And I'd like to take just a quick second to point out the scalability in our hiring. We estimate that we need roughly one washer for every 100 customers that we have, working roughly 20 hours a week or so. So you can see by the chart on the screen that whenever we have 10,000 customers, we estimate that we need roughly 100 washers or so, which is actually very manageable. We acquire new customers by going directly to large commercial office buildings and residential buildings via property management and marketing our services to the people who live and work there. In addition, our building partners will then push New Wash as a cost-free amenity to the building, which is incredibly effective and free direct marketing for us. The really cool thing about our business is that we know that all of our customers are located inside those enormous buildings that we service, and we can reach them through a variety of hyper-targeted ways, as you can see on the screen here. We went to market 7 months ago, and like I said, we have 650 customers on our flexible subscription car wash plan, and we operate across 75 buildings here in town. Some of our customers work at companies such as Yeti, Amazon, Silicon Labs, and LegalZoom, just to name a few of them. We've been growing our customer base 7% week over week since we started the business, and this April we did nearly $20,000 in revenue, and we expect May to be much higher than that. As we continue to refine our go-to-market strategy, on-the-ground operations, and software stack, we feel very confident in our ability to rapidly expand New Wash into many other major U.S. cities. Right now, we're currently seeking $100,000 in seed stage funding, and with this funding, we're going to do a few things, but first and foremost, we're going to launch multiple marketing campaigns so that we can get a firm understanding of our customer acquisition our customer acquisition and marketing strategies as we continue to move forward and grow the business. Once we feel confident in those strategies, we'll ultimately roll out NewWash to a new market and continue to refine our expansion playbook. I really appreciate you guys listening. My contact information is behind me. I'd love to speak with anyone who's interested in having NewWash at their apartment, if we're not already there, or at your place of work, or anyone that's interested in learning more about NewWash from an investment perspective. Our website is also behind me in case you're interested in signing up. If you live at an apartment here in town, there's a great chance we already service you. If you see your company on the screen, we'd love to service you. And if not, then bring us to your office and we'll wash your car for you. Really appreciate you guys listening. Thank you.
Good job. All right, wow. Let's give one more big round of applause for all of them. That was really great. Thank you all for sticking with us through the end. I'm sure you thought it was worth it. Now the last thing we have to do is make our announcement and give away the $5,000 prize. I want to give also a big shout out again to our sponsor, Walmart. Thank you guys so much for helping to make this possible and for being all the other things you do to support all the entrepreneurial activities here at UT and in Austin. So before we announce the $5,000 winner, I'm going to invite someone up here to announce it with me, and that is Melly Price. Melly, you want to come up here with me today? Let's give a round of applause for Melly. Melly is a long-term friend of mine and business partner too. She helped me start Capital Factory back in 2009, and she's was the founder of Frontgate Tickets, one of a very successful startup, not so much a startup anymore, company here in Austin that's now was acquired by Live Nation. Am I getting that right? Live Nation? Yeah, there's not so many options there in the ticketing space, but Live Nation owns that now. She does a lot of different things, but spends most of her time here at UT, where she works now with the Dell Medical School and is running all of the technology innovation there, and what an incredible opportunity that is with so much happening here with the medical school. And what I'm so excited to announce now is that starting next semester in the fall, Melly's going to be joining me as a co-instructor of this class and helping to teach it. Now, those of you who have taken the class know that I don't actually do any teaching. So what that really means is that it's a really strong connection for the class into the Dell Medical School, in particular is one part of that. And I hope is that because of that, that we'll be seeing more biology students and doctors and other people submitting ideas and things into the class. But even if it weren't for the medical school, Melly would be just an incredible addition to this class because of all of her own entrepreneurial experience as a very active investor and all the other things that she brings to the table. So really excited to have you here, Melly. Thanks for coming. So with that, we are now going to announce the winner of the $5,000 prize. We've got a really big check that Sam RTA. That, you know, another person we should say thank you to is Sam RTA. Let's give a round of applause for Sam. Sam took the class himself last year with a startup called Driven, and now he's been here helping everything, all the magic happen this whole time. And both him and Mandy from the computer science department, who's here somewhere as well, in the back waving, all put a lot of work into making all this happen. So thank you very much for that. But with that, I want to announce the $5,000 winner. Now, this is the first time we've had this kind of a prize. We're really excited about it, and I hope we'll only see this go up in future years. But this is a $5,000 grant. It's not an investment. It's just free money. But hopefully we will use this to go help grow our startups. And we, you know, I wasn't really sure how to award that this time. And certainly it was a tough decision, as I think you can see from all the companies that are up here. Not only are they pretty incredible, but they're all really different and at different stages and have accomplished different things. And so in particular for me, what I focused on for this year is the startup that I thought really accomplished the most over the course of the semester and really impressed me and the other mentors and other people that I saw them interact with what they accomplished. And for that, it was actually a pretty easy decision. And the winner is Memory Plush. So come on up. Now, I'm sure, you know, he did a great job pitching that, and this is not about the pitch. This is I knew who the winner was going to be before the pitch, but they did a great job pitching it. And part of the game they play on is you hear about it and you think Memory Plush, they're making pillows? Like what? And when they first came up and talked to me about this idea, that's what I did. I was like, okay, really? But what they impressed me with right away was that, kind of like they showed in the video, well, the first thing they did is they, well, we wanted to see if this has worked. So we made 20 of them, and we took them to the mall, and we sold all of them. And they just walked around selling to people at the mall. And I was like, all right, well, I guess people will buy these because you just proved that they would. And one step after another, it was one thing after where I every time I'd have a doubt, they would go out and do something and prove me wrong and get it to the next step. And I don't think anybody would have predicted at the beginning of the semester that they would have gotten over $50,000 in pre-orders for this memory foam, this lovable loaf of bread, as he called it, that he sells. And they do it with such great humor. But I think this is actually very real, and I think there's a lot of places that they could take this. And more importantly, I really believe in them and what they're doing. And when I think about who can take $5,000 and make that go really far and do a lot with it, I'm really sure that they will. So congratulations, and let's give them all a big round of applause. Thank you very much.